you believe that?
Well, you know, it's interesting that you bring that up, because it's actually come out that George W. did bring in Cheney and Rumsfeld because of that split, and that's then later when Baker and them were sent back in to kind of shut down what they were doing.
That was one of the reasons why I got on the phone in the middle when I was in Montana, and I told Baker, I called him up, I said, what in God's name are you doing sending out the chairman of the Republican Party, who was very bizarre and unusual in his orientations and talking about abortion? And I said, get rid of these guys. And what are you doing with Cheney and Rumsfeld? I mean, these guys were persona non grata for 20 years in our administration. So basically, you have to understand within the American public has to understand that even under Bush Jr., we had basically a quiet civil war that was going on between his father's people, who were non-ideological, and those who try to implement ideology and their own narcissism. What we have now is a very narcissistic, incompetent president with a very dysfunctional White House and a dysfunctional intelligence community.
Well, that was my next question, Dr. Pieczenik, from your perspective, was why did you, in 2002, come on my show to talk about this Bin Laden being in the deep freeze and to question 9/11? We're going to come back, talk about that, and then we're going to go to your phone calls with Dr. Steve Pieczenik. What incredible info. But he told you this Bin Laden thing's a fraud. You know what I can't believe? Just the providence of this radio show, because I'm just an average guy who started reading history books when I was 12 and thought they were interesting and entertaining. And reading history, I learned so much about how the world works today. And then I talked to the general public, who many of them are informed and have street smarts. But if they would really start researching, they would find out how much they're being lied to, and that the culture is getting more and more entitled in Washington. The corporations that have grown up around it, the crony system, are so out of control. Your phone calls for Dr. Steve Pieczenik are coming up in the next segment, and hopefully we can get him back up in the very near future. And I keep asking him this question, and he's answered it in many ways. But just boiling it down in a language that the mainstream media can understand and government can understand, why would they do something that is so cartoonishly satirical, where, and I'm not just saying this to make it come true, because I was pretty depressed yesterday, but now the tables are turning. It is exploding in their face. I mean, it's almost more scary, Doctor, that you're probably right, that they have the power, they have the control, so they're able to do what they want. They think they're smart, but at the end of the day, they're making a lot of things that look like big mistakes as the Republic slides towards collapse. So why? During the break, I said, so you're saying they just did this to make Obama look good? And you said, no, to make him survive.
It's about the word that you want to use right now, the key word that it did all of this PSYOPS resurrection of Osama bin Laden, which is a joke and a sick joke and a cynical joke on the American public, treating them as if we were stupid, is desperation. They are so desperate to make Obama viable, to negate the fact that he may not have been born here, any questions about his backgrounds, any irregularities about his backgrounds, to make him look assertive, to make sure that Gates goes out in a clean sweep and that he's done what he's done. This is a good man, Gates, and bringing in a man who is questionably qualified to be Secretary of Defense, who is questionably qualified to be CIA Director Panetta, to bring in a whole other staff that really has not been very effective, and to reelect this president again so the American public can be duped once again after we've been duped by Bush Jr. and Clinton. The point is, they've underestimated the American public. Again, you can thank David Axelrod of the White House, this very self-aggrandizing, very pretentious man who thinks he understands the American public as he polls them every minute. And basically what we have here is a desperate situation on behalf of an incompetent president who's not told the truth, who hopes to be reelected because he has nothing to offer but words, which are totally meaningless, mm-hmm. and will hopefully get forth. On the other hand, let me warn you that the Republicans and other parties have no candidates that are capable of filling the role that America needs today, which is a pragmatic, non-narcissistic, non-egoistic, practical man or woman who has served our country on behalf of our country, hopefully in the military, hopefully in business, and hopefully has had a clean history and can understand where we're going strategically and tactically. That has not happened in the past 24 years. That's basically where we are today, in desperation with capital cronyism, corruption, and non-transparency. What we need now is Tahrir Square in Washington, D.C., and all over the country where people will go.
We're going to talk about that when we come back and then take calls, but in the minute or two we have left in this short segment, why did you go public in 2002 with something at the time, you know, that sounded a little bit wild to some people, but I knew it had a historical basis, and say
everybody who has accused me of making wild statements regretted it 10 years later. Aldo Moro did, Pol Pot did, Noriega, all regretted the fact when I said to them, you're leaving and you're not staying, they were gone. The reason I came forth and I said, I warned Bush Jr. and Cheney and Rumsfeld, you will pay for the crimes you've committed against the American public, and part of that is this nonsense of Osama bin Laden being the leader of some nonsensical group that we created under the Carter administration, was fostered through tens of years and going into Pakistan through a nonsensical war that didn't exist, to allow men and women to die.
Are you bottom line saying they ran the attacks or they hired some criminal group to do it?
No. They ran the attacks. The 9/11 is a total manufacture of one organization, the White House under Bush Jr. Bush Jr., Cheney, Rumsfeld.
Unbelievable. Bradley, what? Stay there, sir. Stay there.
Halazad, Elliot Abrams, now at the CFR.
Stay there. Repeat that.
I'm happy to confront them.
Stay there. Let's come back and repeat that because the music was playing. This is absolutely devastating. Dr. Steve Pieczenik's got major credibility, and he is going all the way today, putting it on the table. This is off the charts. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Well, the email, the tweets, the phone calls are pouring in. Listeners are just completely amazed by the interview. I really appreciate Dr. Steve Pieczenik spending so much time with us. I'll obviously have to get him back in the near future. And I want to go to some of your phone calls. But I was going back to 2002 when he went public. Then he was saying, I have questions about 9/11. You know, there are issues with this. We created these groups. Now, as we went to break, he was laying it all out and naming names. Dr. Pieczenik, again, who served as Deputy Assistant Secretary of State and or Senior Policy Planner under Secretaries Henry Kissinger, Cyrus Vance, George Shultz, and James Baker. That's three of the most famous kingmakers of the last 100 years right there. Dr. Pieczenik continues to consult to the Department of Defense, ran black ops, major operations, overthrows of governments, you name it, stevepieczenik.com. He is, of course, on record. Tom Clancy helped Tom Clancy write his 26 best-selling New York Times bestsellers with his advice. Several of the characters, like Jack Ryan, are based on him, as well as Richard Clark. And Dr. Pieczenik, uninterrupted by the break, take your time. What was the event of 9/11, A, and B, why was it carried out?
The event of 9/11 was carried out for one purpose. It was carried out to mobilize the American public to go to a war that they didn't need to go to, that they knew nothing about, where we had pre-positioned soldiers in Afghanistan and Iraq 6 to 9 months beforehand. And what it was done, it was based on Paul Wolfowitz's, Richard Cheney, Dick Cheney, Bush Jr., Steve Hadley, Elliot Abrams in the White House, Salmeh Halazad, Dennis Ross, who's now our Stell envoy, who's never been held accountable. You have Condoleezza Rice. You have all the people who were in the military. Particularly the Air Force generals who were involved. They can deny it any much they want, but I have a whole list of names. They know who they are. And the intel, the CIA operatives who worked under SOLIC, Special Operations Low Intensity Conflict, were all involved in what's called a stand-down, a false flag operation in order to mobilize the American public on the false pretense that we were attacked by Al-Qaeda and Osama bin Laden, which was an absolute unmitigated lie. It was told to me, even by the general on the staff of Wolfowitz, I will go in front of a federal committee and swear on perjury who the name was of the individual so that we could break it open. I was furious. I knew it had happened. I taught stand-down and false flag operations at the National War College. I caught it with all my operatives, so I knew exactly what was done to the American public. Believe it or not, I had worked on George Bush Jr.'s campaign with Bob Zelig, not with the Vulcans, but with Bob Zelig, in order to work against Gore, which I regret today, because I had been loyal to his father. And that issue of Osama bin Laden, that had already, who had already been dead, really brought up the issue of the great lie and the great war that was created for us to make sure that we had some type of commitment to a war that was not necessary, where blood and guts were shed for unnecessary reasons for men and women.
Dr. Pieczenik, I've got to stop because this is so dangerous. I believe this is the first time you've gone this far. And when the D.C. madam was on my show and she was trying to tell me during the break names of people, and I said, I don't want to know this. You've got to go public with this, or you're going to end up, you know, committing arcanicide. And obviously you're a tough guy. You're not worried about that. But I mean,
I don't think so.
Well, do you want to go ahead?
Who I mentioned understands that we all have a mutual, let's say, a mutual deterrent relationship. It's not going to be to their benefit.
No, I understand. But I mean, you don't want to say the name of the general.
The general who swore to me? No. I will do that in the federal court so that we can unravel this legally, not with the stupid 9/11 commission. That was absurd. That was the most absurd thing I had heard. That's why I came on your show, Alex. One of the reasons when I went on the shows like Chris Matthews, CNN, all of that nonsense, is they wanted me to say certain things, and Matthews had no idea what we were talking about. And going to Iraq at the time, you had all these anchor men and basically pretty boys up there.
Yeah, I've met some of these people. They are like children.
They're children. They had no idea whether I was a deputy assistant secretary or what that meant. All they wanted me to do was to give sound bites, and I said I refused. Then they asked, basically. So I found you by chance, and I said, you know what? I heard your show. I thought you were extremely bright. This is not flattery, as we talked about. And I was more than grateful to be on your show. When I went on your show and I told you Osama bin Laden was dead in 2002, I wasn't hypothesizing. I knew it because he had Marfan syndrome. I knew the CIA had investigated, had treated him in a Dubai hospital, an American hospital. They can deny anything they want. That's all they do. They run around creating problems.
By the way, after you said that, Dan Rather did a report on it and interviewed the people at the hospital who saw it.
Oh, they did. I didn't even see that with Dan Rather. But my point is, you still maintained your credibility. And because 10 years later, 9 years later, you mentioned my name, I was stunned. I had no idea because I was working on another company. I'm basically an entrepreneur who volunteers my time for the military to help them out. And basically, as an American, I said, I'm sick of this. And I went back on your show to say, this is disgusting. This Osama bin Laden issue, again, keystones the issue about an incompetent, dysfunctional administration that is lying once again to the American public. We can't continue this. This is why I went on your show. I don't care whether Obama's desperate or he's incompetent or he's narcissistic. I care that he does not get reelected. I care that the Republicans don't get reelected. I care that the American people stand up once again and say we've had enough of this bullshit with all these politicians on the Republican and Democratic side, the capital cronyism, the entire incompetency, the transnational corporations. And believe me, I don't come from the left or the right. You don't serve Nixon, Reagan, and Bush and come out with these comments. I'm not losing friends, and I'm not making friends. I don't really care about those things. I do care that as an American, don't mess with me. You can imagine the real word I wanted to use.
No, I understand. Did you hear my story about...
Don't mess with any of my people in America. That's it. And the politicians think that they can mess with
you. You're not their slave, and you hate seeing America being gutted by crony capitalists.
You got it. Not only crony capitalists, but despicable lies and manipulation.
Did you hear my story about Lionel Chetwin, the White House media head for propaganda?
Oh, that's absurd. It's absurd. You need a White House. Think about it for a moment, Alex George. You need somebody to come out and talk, to say, to interpret to a bunch of what? Sycophants and reporters in the day of the Internet? What do you have reporters there for? To translate on a piece of paper what you were taking? I mean, think of the notion of the newspaper now. It makes no sense, Alex.
Well,
it's an arcane concept.
My point is, they all think they're a bunch of gangsters because there I am about to go on a TV show I'm in the bathroom. Here comes Lionel Chetwin, who made the made-for-TV movie about Bush being a hero on 9/11. And he came over like a gangster and started getting in my face going, we're going to effing get you. And as soon as I bowed up to him, he almost urinated on himself and ran out of the room. I'm saying, these are the type of people. I mean, if you're going to threaten somebody in a bathroom, you better be ready. I mean, do you see what I'm saying?